take this I will take this opportunity to by introducing CA Selvin Prabhakar sir. Today's topic is business ethics and principles, a biblical perspective by CA Selvin Prabhakar. CA Selvin Prabhakar is a Loyola College passed out BSc Max in 1983. He lives in Chennai. Joined CA articleship immediately with S.N. Mukherjee and Co. CA firm in Chennai. Qualified as a chartered accountant in his first attempt itself. On his qualifying, immediately he has joined as a partner in his associate firm, S.N. Mukherjee associate firm, Inna Krishnamurthy and Co. And that company firm has taken him as a partner and started his practice as a CA in 1987. And he is having more than 30 years, three decades of vast experience as a chartered accountant. After 2 years, he was working with K.N.R. Krishnamurthy. He has started his own CA firm in the name and style of S.C. Prabhakar & Co. After 5 years, Mr. Prateep has joined as a partner in his firm and it has become a partnership firm. He is having the passion of learning and more interested in computer and introduce the latest developments of computerization in his firm, and it has become his lifelong passion also. Have been extensively involved in our Christian association, churches, dioceses, hospitals, schools and colleges, and all types of educational institutions. He is involved in the audit of Church of South India, Madras Diocese, and with his valued association, there were a lot of improvements happened in the finance and accounts. He is very active in the social media, fast checking, which is being experienced by all in our group by his postings. That also, he is the first person who is posting the current affairs and current notifications, surplus, etc. One of our colleagues who asked me about Mr. Selvin Prabhakar, where is Mr. Selvin Prabhakar, whether he is working in a central government as a key position, as he is posting all these circulars and notifications and immediately it is not published by others, it has been published by Mr. Selvin in the social media. That is what he is having the interest in this. He is spending equal amount of time, of his time daily on following Christian theology, especially expository preaching and Christian apologetics, and sharing the same to family, friends, to colleagues, and to all required people and associates. Currently, he is much interested in economics, management, world, and financial affairs, and very much in legal matters, including IBC, WPs, GST, and income tax. About his family, he is happily married with Mrs. Ruth and blessed with a daughter and son. Mrs. Ruth is a postgraduate in physics and running a private limited company with his colleague and friend in overseas studies and sending aspirant students to Ukraine for their medical studies. His daughter is also a chartered accountant working with the BWC, happily married and blessed with a daughter. Son-in-law is a life coaching. He's in life coaching. Son is a mechanical engineer and an animator and working with the Mumbai-based animation studio and happily married in November 2020. Daughter-in-law also is an animator and designer by profession and working with VGN Group, Chennai. With this brief introduction, I hand over the session to Mr. Selvin, CA Selvin Prabhakar, to carry on his topic on business ethics and principles, a biblical perspective. Thank you. Over to Selvin, sir.
Yeah. So I have the share permission, no?
Yes, sir, you are having, sir.
Print anga vandiruka bar. can see it now?
Yes, sir. We are seeing your screen.
So, when Kanagaraj sir asked me about the topic, I was in many mind which topic to select. That's why I told him I will confirm by Monday. So over that overnight and Sunday, I came up with this topic. I Monday morning when he reminded me, that's why within few minutes I could confirm to him. So I thought this subject I will handle it in such a way that I'll make it from secular to biblical view. Was my thinking of doing it. So first I want to say why ethics and principle in business and profession. The important thing is it is generally accepted that ethics and principles are indispensable. Warren Buffett, emphasized it in looking for people to hire, you look for three qualities: integrity, intelligent and energy, and if they don't have the first, other two will kill you. That's how he projects it. Sig Ziglar, foundation stones for balanced success are honesty, character, integrity, faith, love, and loyalty. That's how he. The one thing which I appreciated very long back is the Jack Welch, he was the chairman of and CEO of General Electric. He was very famous that time. So he says first type shares our values. That is, he says his managers, he used to categorize into four categories. Type one shares our values and makes the numbers. That is, sky is the limit for them in the company. Type two shares the company value, but misses the numbers. Typically given another chance or two, not beyond that.
I'm sorry to be interrupting you. Can you put it on a slideshow? Because so that, you're not able to see the font clearly. At the bottom, that's good. Thank you. Thank you. Sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. Type three doesn't share the values, doesn't make the numbers. So they are gone. But interestingly, he talks of one more type called type four. That is, they are the type who delivers the numbers but doesn't share the values of the company. So he says it is very tough to get rid of them because they are after all helping with the numbers. So, but he says in the long run, they will destroy the values and end up in the company being the sufferer. So they have to be let go. And most important thing he says on that subject is that you don't let them go and hide the fact that they have sent for which reason by saying that for personal reason and all. But you have to be very clear to the others that why they had to go, so that in the long run, the people understand that values of the company is very important. And sometimes people say, oh, what if my boss is not so honest? What do I do? But that is a fallacy, because we know that honor among thieves. That means among thieves also, people who are engaged in dishonest activities also, within among them, they expect integrity and sincerity. That means, so it is universal, we can't ignore it. And next thing is Warren Buffett again, he says, it takes 20 years to build a reputation and just 5 minutes to ruin it. If you think about it, you will do things differently. All of us, we know Enron. In 2000, December 1, filed what was then the largest bankruptcy in the United States. The stock price crashed from high of $90 a share to 60 cents per share. In September 2001, Enron was trading at $70. And October, just about a month, it fell below $1. Between 1996 to 2000, before their crash, their revenue increased 750%, which is very phenomenal. The collapse was less than 1 month. In the special issue of Business Week devoted to 25 ideas for the post-Enron setting, at the top of the list of these ideas were the idea of integrity. They put it as trust, fairness, and integrity matter, and they matter to the bottom line. This is what Business Week wrote after the demise of Enron. From a Christian worldview, good ethics is always good business, irrespective of the bottom line. This is because from God's perspective, what constitutes good business is much broader than a company's bottom line. Good business from biblical perspective includes how you do business. A company that makes a lot of money using immoral means or providing an immoral product service would be viewed by God as a failure, regardless of the profitability of the company. We should also realize that just because a company or an individual has strong ethics doesn't automatically mean that they will be profitable. They could be having integrity, but maybe they are incompetent or running a business which is having a lousy product or so on. In the short term, good ethics is usually costly. If it is not so, everyone will be on the ethics bandwagon. The Bible is full of references, the prosperity of the wicked. The psalmist regularly lament that the wicked are profitable. Some of the most profitable industries today are those which we would classify as wicked, such as pornography, illegal drugs, so on. It is also true that righteous man prospers too. But in the Bible, there is no necessary connection between righteousness and prosperity. So we should not have our values mixed up. In the long run, however, integrity usually pays off. Here is why. Integrity builds trust. Trustworthiness is a critical component in building a successful business over time. People will generally go out of the way and sometimes even pay higher prices to do business with people they trust. And most importantly, they will make pains to avoid doing business with people they don't trust. One of the great myths of business world is that greed is the engine of our economic system. Greed is good, but mostly it is people wrongly attributed to Adam Smith. The reality is that trust is the engine of our economic. Without trust, business relationship don't happen, and the cost of doing business increases astronomically. Literally millions of every day, so much happens through credit, and even people go for employment believing that at the end of the month they'll get their paycheck. So trust is a foundation for everything. So proverb in 11:3 says the integrity of the upright guides them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by their duplicity. What I've just said is simple, that we have to have honesty and integrity. It is very simple, but it is not very complex. But we should not think that it is easy to follow. It is simple, not complex, but not easy. General Norman Schwarzkopf, the American general who commanded the Allied forces in Gulf War, has this to say. The truth of the matter is that you always know the right thing to do. The hard part is doing it. I repeat it. The truth of the matter is that you always know the right thing to do, but the hard part is doing it. Why a biblical perspective? So if we agree that ethics and principles are vital in the marketplace, that leads us to some important issues. What is the right ethics and principle? How do I equip myself to do the right thing? Not sometimes, but all the time. How does the Bible come into picture in this? The important thing to note here is that these three questions cannot be treated in isolation, but they are dependent on one another and are interconnected. Firstly, we need to know what is good, what is wrong, what is acceptable and what is unacceptable. That's why we have the laws of the land and various codes and standards. Unless there is a codification of acceptable standards or mandatory standards, no one will know what to follow and no one will be sure what to be expected from the other person. But here, we are not talking of standard of work or service, but we are talking of moral law. If there is to be a moral law, there needs to be a moral lawgiver. We normally come across the argument that we don't need a moral lawgiver, as all humans know naturally in their conscience what is right. This argument cannot be accepted for the simple reason that what is one man's acceptable behavior may not be so for the another. Of course, there is no problem in terms of common, basic, clear-cut beliefs, but probably problem comes in areas where there are different views based on culture, ethnicity, or religion. As a famous Christian apologist once equipped, in some cultures, the law is that love your neighbor, and in other cultures, it is you eat your neighbor. The basis for ethics in business is not what our heart says. It is not what our heart feels. But we want to reflect the character of God. So here is the principle for ethics in business. We should seek to emulate the character of God in our business transactions. God is fair, just, honest, and generous. And we are called to be fair, just, honest, and generous. We always hear that honesty is the best policy. But I have a serious issue with that statement. When we say something as best, that means there is something that is next best. In this case, it implies that honesty is the best policy and dishonesty is the next best policy. But the fact of the matter is that we are to be always honest in our dealings, because that is what reflects God's character in our life. We learned two things from Bible. The first thing is that there is God, there is good, there is bad. But the most important thing is that God determines which is good and which is not. So we believe that there is right and wrong, and that God determines what is right and wrong. So as Christians, we believe that what Bible teaches can be standard that is expected of us to be followed. Another reason is that modern Western civilization, all the former colonies of the European empires are founded on Judeo-Christian worldview and mostly derived from the moral law from the Bible. So this answers my first and third question, that is, what is right and wrong and why the Bible comes into the picture. However, the second question, that is, how do I equip myself if I do the right thing, if I have to do the right thing? It follows from it that Hebrews 13 verses 18 to 22 comes to my mind. Pray for us, for we are sure that we have a clear conscience, desiring to heart act honorably all things. I urge you the more earnestly to do this in order that I may be restored to you the sooner. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with good, everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever, ever. Amen. The author of the Hebrews says at least five things here. Number one, he urges us to be desiring to act honorably in all things. Number two, he prays that our Lord equips us with everything good. Number three, that we may do God's will. And to Lord Jesus be glory forever ever. From this, we can take it that we have to act honorably. We have to do God's will. Our Lord has to equip us to do the right thing. And most important, to remember that it is for the glory of God. It is not for us to gloat over that we are being a model Christian, but give effect to our Lord's command in Matthew 5:16. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good work and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Which was also reflected in John 15:8, when Jesus says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. So it is not that we are being good, because we feel good when we are doing something good, but we are to do the right thing because that is our what our Lord demands of us, and that is what glorifies His name. In the words of William T. J. Thomas, be careful how you live. You may be the only Bible some persons ever read. As St. Paul Paul warns us in 1 Corinthians 8:9, but take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. So we have to live a Christian life so that we reflect our Lord in our life, so as to shine light on the knowledge of our Lord, and also not being a stumbling block to others, not by living up to that standard. There is no two. We sometimes mistakenly think that proper professional world is secular, and it is not fashionable or acceptable to bring in our Christian beliefs to that. But the truth of the matter is that world expects Christian professional to be different and be somewhat better in terms of ethics, dependability, sincerity, and so on. That I have learned firsthand in my personal experience. They may not have any idea as to what the Bible teaches, or may not be familiar with Christian theology, but they expect something better. It could be as value as it gets. When they do not experience that better moral standard or experience lack of ethics or sincerity, the disappointment is very real. And the remark is that, oh, he is being a Christian, I expected something better, but it trails off. There is one more important misconception that needs to be looked into. We somehow tend to suffer from a notion that our vocation is secular life, that we live 6 days of the week, which the mobile alarm calls weekdays, and our Christian life is something we live on Sunday. Nothing can be far from truth. What we are and what we stand for is one and the same, whether it is in our personal life, family life, or professional life. We are not created with double face to have double face life. Ethical challenges are faced in the workplace. Temptations exist to compromise Christian worldview. One common strategy for dealing with ethical challenges in the workplace is to create a separate worlds that you operate in. Your life in workplace and your life privately. Each sphere then has its own set of rules and guidelines that you follow. That is, you have one set of moral rules for the workplace and a different and presumably higher set of rules for your private life. You realize that the workplace is a very competitive place that requires you to set aside some of your Christian value virtues, such as love, compassion, and sometimes even fairness. You insist that those values are fine for private life, but the environment of business is such that you must play by a different set of rules in order to succeed. You see colleagues of yours who claim to be Christian, but who are involved in some very questionable business practices, and you admit that this way of compartmentalizing your life is may not be that unusual. Perhaps a lot of people accept what Albert Kerr writes years ago, that a sudden submission to Christian ethics would produce the greatest economic upheaval in history. What he meant by that is that if everyone practiced Christian ethics consistently in the workplace, there will be a chaos in the world economy. Now, by contrast, this is the statement of the celebrated author, late Norman Vincent Peale. Integrity pays you. Don't have to cheat to win. Incidentally, Norman Vincent Peale was raised as a Methodist and ordained as a Methodist minister in 1922. Of course, Peale changed his religious affiliation to the Reformed Church in America in 1932. Right now, if you ask someone to which one of this is followed, whether the first one or the second one, what would be the answer? Majority would actually say that they would believe number one. And which one do you think they actually live by? I think a lot of people live by the first way. And I say this because the number of business people who approach their spiritual life as a church on Sunday and work on Monday, and never the twain shall meet. Part of the reason for that is that they do not know how to put Sunday into concrete practice on Monday, and by doing so, business and professional people privatize their life. Or take the statement by Ray Kroc, founder of McDonald's, who claimed to be a Christian, who said, "My priorities are God first, family second, and McDonald's hamburgers third. And when I go to work on Monday morning, that order reverses." What he meant by is that he has two sets of priorities, one for the workplace and the other for private life, and a corresponding set of rules for each. From a Christian worldview, compartmentalizing your life is full of difficulties. The Bible is very clear that we are to live all our life under the Lordship of Christ. He is the boss over every aspect of our life. No part of our life is to be exempt from his scrutiny and direction. Following Christ is not something that we reserve for the weekend. It is a full-time vocation. Even in the statement of Ray Kroc and Albert Carr is the assumption that having integrity in the workplace is not good business. That is, it is costly to one's bottom line. But most people have the intuitive sense that that is not true, that doing the right thing in the workplace will pay off somehow in the long run. Stephen Gerrard, the unbelieving millionaire of Philadelphia, told his clerks one Saturday that they had to come the next day and unload a shipment which had just arrived. Well, that next day was Sunday. One young man stepped up to the desk and said nervously, "Mr. Gerrard, I can't work on Sunday." "Well, sir," replied the employer, "if you can't do as I wish, we can separate." "I know that, sir," said the young man. "And I know, too, I have a widowed mother to care for, but I cannot work on Sunday." "Very well," Mr. Gerrard said. "So go to the cashier's desk and he will settle with you." For 3 long weeks, the biographer says, the young man tramped the streets looking for work. And one day, a bank president asked Gerrard to name a suitable person for cashier of a new bank about to be started. After reflecting a moment, Gerrard named the young man he had just fired. "But I thought you said you fired him," said the bank president. "I said, sir," he said, "because he wouldn't work on Sunday and I had to fire him. I tell you, the man that would lose his job on account of principle is the man with whom you can trust your money." That is why the need to have biblical perspective is important. We labor under this misconception because we tend to read the Bible in bits and pieces or as daily verse or promise word of the month and so on. Can you imagine facing our examination by reading some study material randomly and in bits and pieces? But that's what we do when it comes to most important examination of our life, that is our life. Unless we read the Bible in full and a systematic manner, we will be under the wrong notion that Bible is for spiritual matter and for heavenly life. And we need moral gurus and moral self-help books to lead our professional life. But the astonishing fact is that most of the self-help books just rephrase the wisdom of Bible while leaving out any reference to God and churn out so-called worldly wisdom. My question is, why not go to the original lawgiver and the original standard rather than settle for second rendering of sometimes twisted and truncated? As Paul says, it's most important that we should know what God's will in our life is before we venture upon to live our life. Romans 12:1-2. "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." So we should know his will, and very importantly, we should not be conformed to this world. As Paul says, God's will is good and acceptable and perfect. And also, as he says in Ephesians 2:10, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good work, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So to summarize, we need to know God's moral standards and teaching, which are relevant to our professional life. We need God's help to equip us to meet the standard in our life. And this is to glorify his name and not our personal glory, self-righteousness, or gloating. We are being equipped by God is important. As I quoted General Norman Schwarzenegger the truth of the matter is that you always know the right thing to do, but the hard part is doing it. Everyone knows what is right, but not everyone does what is right. Australian cricketer commentator Richard Benard frequently used to say, captaincy is 90% luck and 10% skill, but don't try it without that 10%. Similarly, ethics is a combination of knowledge, circumstances, but without God's help, we can't do it. There is another important issue that is to be kept in mind. What is practiced in real life following the ethics is in word and spirit. In the Sermon on the Mount, our Lord repeats himself as, you have heard that it was said to those of old, but I say to you that he keeps repeating it, essentially to emphasize the fact that the action is secondary, but the thought in heart is primary. Example, Matthew 5:43-44. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Another thing is that it is not just to follow it with a sense of obligation, but with pleasure, as the psalmist says in Psalm 119:16, I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. In Psalm 119:143, he says, trouble and anguish have found me out, but your commandments are my delight. The Bible commands us in 1 John 2:6, whoever says he abides in him ought to walk the same way in which he walked. And in 1 John 2:3, and by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. And our Lord himself said in John 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I have one very helpful thing in our, and we have one very helpful thing in our favor too. In case of the legal standards and codification, we have to commit them to our memory and keep remembering them. But here we don't have to commit anything to memory or keep remembering them. It is like riding a cycle or driving a car. Once we are familiar with it, it happens automatically and subconsciously. That is because our Lord has simplified the entire laws and prophets into a simple rule of thumb. Mark 12:28-31. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing one another. And seeing that he answered them well, he asked him, which commandment is the most important of all? Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this. Essentially, our Lord is saying, love is the foundation of everything. If we love our God, we won't violate the second commandment. That is, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. If we love our neighbor, we won't steal from him, we won't murder him, or will not covet his possessions. So I hope you agree. The necessity for moral standard and ethics, that the Bible is necessary our standard, that we need our Lord to equip us to follow the same, that we need to follow it in letter and spirit, that we do it with delight and not out of sense of obligation, and love is the foundation for all of it. There are numerous direct principle, commandments, and moral law which are in black and white, which we don't have get any confusion or doubt in our mind. But there are many areas where there is no direct reference in Bible to check whether something is right or wrong. Now, there are things that are standard in the Bible as exactly as we would like to have them state. We like to have little vision holes where it can say, well, it is all settled. But we don't like to extend ourselves and really have to think through some things. But there are things in our lifetime, in our culture, as there has been in every lifetime and culture, every culture, there are gray areas. They are not stated in the Bible as right, and they are not stated in Bible as wrong. And so has to be a decision made about those gray area things. Now, we do not know there are some things are wrong. We don't really have any problem with this. The Bible says not to kill, steal, not to so on. And you know that those things are right. There are many things that are good. But in the middle of these good and bad, there are those things that the Bible never comments about that falls on the area, gray area. So how do we decide? How do we know what is right, what is wrong in the gray area? So it is, do you have the right with, so it is not simple as whether it is right or wrong. Do you have the right within your liberty to do whatever you want, no matter? So where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. For freedom, Christ has set us free. And James says that lives are governed by the perfect law of liberty. But 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 9 says, take heed lest by any means the liberty of you becoming a stumbling block to them that are weak. Peter puts it this way, don't use your liberty as a clock of maliciousness to willfully injure somebody. So how do we decide? What do you do in your life when you got one of those gray area things? Do you have a process by which you make decision? I have come prepared a small list. Let me offer you a series of times which we can filter through those difficult things. Number one is excess. First thing I ask myself about a gray area thing is to do I need it or is it excess baggage? Do I need it? Hebrews 12:1 says, seeing we are about with no great cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight. In other words, there is no sense in running race, dragging a ball and chain. Second, principle of expedience. And this is the kind of the other side of it. 1 Corinthians 6:12, it says, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. That means useful. Is it useful? Not only does not have a negative effect, but does it have a positive effect? If I do this, is it going to have help me? Is this something I need to be a better man of God, a better woman of God? Is this something very positive that I have to do to increase my effectiveness as a believer? Thirdly, the principle of emulation. If we say we abide in him, John 2:6, if we say we abide in him, we ought to also walk even as he walked. The principle of emulation is this, is that this what Christ would do? When you get into the thing, first you say is, do I need it? Second, you say, is it going to help me? Third, is this what Jesus would do in the same situation? That is very helpful. Fourthly, the principle of evangelism. If I do this, is it going to enhance my testimony to an unbeliever? Colossians 4:5 says, walk in wisdom toward them that are outside. In other words, whatever I do, it should be done wisely toward the people who don't know Christ, that they might better see Christ in me, that there may be a better base of testimony for me. So if I do this, will it create a better evangelistic platform for me? The fifth one, edification. Will I be stronger in Christ? 1 Corinthians 10:23. All things are lawful, but all things edify not. Not everything builds me up. I might be lawful to do it, but it won't build me up. I ought to really think through whether it builds me up or not. Whether I can gain positive thing of this to build me up in Christ. Sixth one, principle of exaltation. If I do it, will it exalt the Lord? That is a great principle. Will it exalt God? If I do this, will it exalt Lord? Seventh, on the principle of example. If I do this, will it set the right pattern of righteousness for my brother? Will it be an act of love toward him? Will it be done to show him what is right, to lead him in the right way? Romans 14:13 says, don't do anything to make him stumble. 1 Corinthians 8:9 says the same thing. 1 Corinthians 8 says the same thing. I will eat no meat while the world stands, because I might make my brother offend. Here is the principle of setting a loving example. So let's call it loving example. Now, all of those principles are just drive us to 1 Corinthians, where Paul says, be just the last one. There has to be a long-range, timeless cultural principle or set of values to determine. Everything revolves around our relationship with God, our relationship with the world, and to ourselves. actually, with this, I'm almost through. Actually, I've compiled a list of about 33 verses. I will share it as a PDF, which I think it can be shared, because I thought going into individual Bible verses, all of us, we know this person. I thought I'll just collect it under one category so that we can make use of it. With this, I complete my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Selvin, sir, for giving importance of the biblical things. That is integrity, place of trust in foundation for everything. Honesty and integrity in the long run will pay off. What is the right ethics and principles? What is good and what is wrong? What is acceptable and what is non-acceptable? God is fair, just, and honest and generous, and we are called to be fair and just. Everything is to the glory of God. Reflect our Lord in our life. Present your bodies as loving God. Glorify His name. The trust of the God is matters is that. Like that, you have given lot of importance to us. To be as a Christians, we have to be not only reading the Bible and the verses on bits and pieces, but we have to be living God's like that. Thank you very much for your abundant blessings on us by giving the webinar, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Any interaction also will be good. Thank you very much, Sebastian, sir, for the feedback.
Thank you, sir. Can I ask you a question? Sir, I am Abraham Zakaria here.
Yes, sir. I can see you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, I am not a successful chartered accountant. You know, in the usual way we see, I am making it very clean, because I have not made any money except by whatever I have the small way. Nothing more than that. Even whatever the house I bought, everything is from something else. I had some real estate and I sold and I made it, not from the practice. So to me, what you said about the Norman Vincent Peale is very true. And I found we have a feeling that you have to be successful. To be successful means you have to be rich. But there's something I found is losing. We lose our happiness. That is my reading. I'm not saying it should be true for others. But there's something you are losing your happiness. We can't be happy all the time. Then what next level is the peace of mind. I have a person, I have peace of mind. It is not that very happy situation, but peace of mind. And I have, that is something, I this is my experience. The first time I'm telling somebody, even our church also, I have not shared this to this extent. And initially, it was very difficult because you are tempted to get some money, something extra. You feel like taking because you want to show at least to, you know, something you want to show. But there, to a great extent, probably somehow I managed it. I'm not saying no. So there is in my clients and group, people have a feeling that, oh, you go to him, he will not do anything. He won't be able to deliver it. Yes, I said, yes, I can do it. What I'm trying to say is that is a very, very difficult situation. But so far, you have covered it to an extent. I think we have to give this kind of orientation to at least Christian young chartered accountants. They should realize that this is not life. This is not making the money. Whatever what we have written, maybe you can make it in a small way or one video or something so that we can reach out to them and share it with them. I have another point. I have not seen a role model for CA or other profession. I have not seen a role model who doesn't take money. All those who are having name and fame are having a different style. So it is very saddening me. Secondly, last point is that we talk so many things. We means the Christian community, Christian leaders, people who are in the preaching, evangelism, everything, but they don't walk the talk. A very sad thing. Somebody got income tax raid, and I don't have to tell you so many things. So these are my concerns, or these are the things I would like to share it with you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, when you said peace of mind, immediately it struck me that a good conscience gives a peace of mind and good night's sleep also.
Yeah, no problem with the sleep.
Sagarya, sir, actually, as you said in your
portion, one portion I covered in the prosperity and being a standard, it's not necessarily interlinked.
Yeah,
that is true.
That's the point.
In fact, about this not taking money and all, no. In fact, one of my earliest in my articleship, we had a client in I don't want to name in the Broadway. They were the manufacturers of bifocal lens for the Spectre. They are surname I can say Patel. So you can assume the community, everything. So his father, old man, and two sons were doing the business. From day one, I knew till I moved away from the firm, no? They will not allow us to pay even 1 rupee also as bribe to any authorities. He said, you tell me what to do, I will do it. If I have to pay tax, I don't mind. If I they seal my place, I don't mind. I will do it correctly. I will not, like that. There are, as you said, you have not seen, but I have seen at least one. So,
oh, great.
Difference. I hope I have not taken too much time. I was little concerned.
You have more time, sir. I think there's another half an hour more.
No, actually, I have the PDF. I will share it that verses. Because I was not very particular to go run by one verse at a time like that. What, John, you're not saying anything.
No, I'm waiting for others to say. Anyway, I mentioned your name, me, I will say. Excellent presentation. Thank you so much.
I'm seeing only more videos around.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Excellent. Thank you so much. I think you can go and preach in churches also. The way you brought out the truth, beautiful. But I thought you were going a little faster because I was
little time conscious.
I understand. I want to digest the truth that you're saying, get into my heart, and soak on that, and then go to the next one. That's the way how we read the Bible. Anyway, I'm going to request you to share your presentation in our CS group. Okay, so that I will share it with everybody, including the verses. I will meditate on whatever you talked about, especially the gray areas where we want to, how to get the clarity. It's wonderful, I tell you. So beautiful. I'm really thankful to God for you and for the clarity with which you brought it. And regarding Brother Main Zachariah's question, I had a similar experience again during my articleship. So I was going for audit, and this is a private limited company, owned by Christians. And then they took a North Indian as a partner, as a director. So the Christians, one fine day, there was one Christian and a non-Christian. The Christian came to me and asked me, John, what is my tax liability, personal tax? I said, this is the one. He said, no, John, I can't pay so much. What is that? Is there any way to do it? I said, this is a maximum. You meet my partner here. And he was trying to somehow, all means, right? When I say all means, to reduce the taxes. There was this Hindu guy, you know, he came. He's not a Hindu man. He's an Arya Samaj person. He came and said, what is my tax liability? I said, this is, sir. Yes, John, I'll pay. You freeze it and give it to me, I'll pay that. No questions asked, nothing. So later on, I went to the audit, and I was doing the audit, and was quite happy with me. So he said, John, come with me to Gymkhana Club for lunch. He never takes anybody. So when I was having lunch, I asked him, why are you so different? What is that difference? Because I noticed many guys would like to come and reduce the tax liability. But whereas Manish said, this is the tax liability, you happily paid. He said, John, I will take only what is due to me. What is not due to me, I will not take. I mean, he's an engineer by profession. So when I started my work, I was posted in Delhi, and I bought an air conditioner. Those days, air conditioners were not easy. So I bought an air conditioner from customs house, and I set up the air conditioner for a birthday party. It was not working. Being an engineer, I opened the air conditioner. I saw inside full of imported watches, huge money. Immediately I closed and called the customs guys. And I told them, here I bought an air conditioner and I opened it full of imported watches. So please come and take that. The customs officer said, do you understand what you're talking, Mr. Praveen? His name is Praveen. You will not know him. I will give you one day's time. You think over it and then call me back. I will not report anybody. Then Praveen replied, said, no. I mean, even if you give me 1 month time, this is not mine. What I not earned is not mine. You come and take it immediately because this is not belonging to mine. He said, I'm having a birthday party now. Let the birthday party get over. It may be over another 1 or 2 hours time. After that, you can come and pick it up. That gentleman saw this man's honesty. He came with those days, Doordarshan. Crew came and then took it and then he put it in Doordarshan, Delhi. And they gave a little money. But he said, what is not mine is mine, John. I've learned it right from the beginning. God has blessed him. Right? So, I have seen many people where honesty pays. And again, Prabhakar said, blessing need not necessarily is the money, the wealth that we have. But God takes care of whatever we need. When we are truthful, when we follow His principles, He will take care of our needs. That's my experience, right? I'm not blessed with so much, but whatever I need, God has given me. I don't aspire for more, but I know God has blessed me because I am being blessing to so many people. That's one way of blessing of God. Thank you so much, Brother Selvin. I would like to share your presentation in the group, and also the recording will be shared. Yeah. The individual members also sir, share. So
John,
this
sir, I'm with you. The same experience I was also having. So what you shared is correct.
Because as you rightly said, no, about this prosperity and suppose we think that being good will get us more, that means that the whole motive is wrong. Such a Bible keeps saying that our selfish motives is wrong. Then to think that, I should be this way so that I'll be better off means then that it becomes a very circular error.
Sir, unfortunately, this prosperity gospel sells small. I don't have to explain more about that, isn't it? Of our preachers, isn't it?
But always I think, that is why I learned a lesson. Because, see, in our group itself, we have diversity. In terms of denomination, and within denomination itself, we have beliefs and so on. So I sometimes used to pick up argument over theology in denomination ways. Then only I realized, I was reading C.S. Lewis book, I came across a peculiar thing. Then I realized something, which is Paul also noted, that we have to agree on everything. My point is that there are so many things on which we agree, but we don't understand much. So why don't we talk about those and get our knowledge improved instead of looking into things over which we don't agree. But as Christian group, all of us, we agree on a basic concept of Christianity. That's why we are Christian. That is, we had the Trinity, Jesus is the Savior, He rose, died, buried, and the basic things we don't disagree. Maybe we disagree on what is child baptism or adult baptism. All that is not, my opinion, fundamental to our belief. So when we share so much and so many things we don't know about which we share common belief, so better to talk about it. And that's why I try not to injure it. As to Abraham's comment about this, no? I was going to say that when I got diverted. In the long run, everybody understands what is truth. In the short run, like, you know, like instant noodle. You may find it very tasty. But later on, people, when they grow up, no, they realize which is truth, which is healthy, all that naturally comes, and God helps in getting us to know. But one thing and my personal thing is, over a period, no, we mature. So we start somewhere like children, then slowly we mature. So I was watching a video about couple of videos, and that it was that video presenter was commenting on false preaching. He was mentioning 7-8 prominent preachers, American preachers. Out of their preaching, he was just picking one messages from each, which is very controversial, which can border on false preaching. So this man was giving that presentation to say, many of the time we cannot label many preachers as false teachers, because majority of their teaching is right. But occasionally they drift into some questionable preaching. So we should not label anybody as false preachers and stay away. By that way, we may lose some good preaching also, he was commenting.
Let me also clarify one thing. I'm not against prosperity. I'm not against wealth. And God blesses you, it is good. Right? And God knows to whom he should give, he will give it. The only thing is, the Bible says, we should not be greedy after money. Right? We should do our job and God will bless us. When God blesses us, when God gives it, I mean, he knows when to give, when not to give. But we should do our work. And to whom to give also, he knows that. So I'm not against, that should not mean that we should live in poverty, like the olden days thinking, you know, olden days people were thinking that if I'm a Christian, I should live in poverty. That's not what I think. Because when God called Abraham, he blessed him. He blessed him so much that he had accumulated so much of wealth. Possibly did not own a piece of land, but there was a lot of cattle for him that he and his brother's son had to fight. The workers were fighting, which one to. So God will bless, when we are honest. But that will come. But sometimes he may not also. So let's not worry about too much, but let's do God's work, as Brother Sylvain talked about, following the principles of God, biblical principles, and things will automatically come. Right? Thank you.
You are sorry about that little boy who refused touching. That was really nice and very appropriate.
Hi, this is Maxwell. Sorry, I joined pretty late. I got caught up with something else. I couldn't join, but I just got a few snippets of the last pieces. And I think I was very unfortunate that I was unable to join from the start. I did hear the inputs from Mr. Abraham and John Ravindra sir as well, and Selvin. I think excellent points which are all coming up. Quick input from my side is, I just wanted to again touch upon that one part where we spoke about success. And I think what we should all be focusing on is not financial success, but we should all be focusing on spiritual success. I think that's where people tend to always make the mistake. As John, you mentioned about when Abraham, we have so many more other examples. If you take even Solomon, he never asked God for riches or anything. He only asked him for wisdom. But God knew him, right? And the riches and everything else, they followed. Right. And again, it's not a question that, so you do this, you will definitely get riches. God knows what you need. And it's only what you need is what he will provide. And, again, there are so many stories of, let's say, the lame man. If he sees the man with the 2 feet, he then knows what he's missing. But you have 2 feet, so you're not bothered about it. But if you didn't have 2 feet, then you would have realized the actual loss that you have. So, we should all be thankful to God for all the blessings that he has given us. Every single thing is actually a blessing. Today, if we are even sitting here at this this session, it's actually a blessing. It's only because of God's grace that we're all here. I think that's a very key point. So I think, yeah, spiritual success is, I think, what we should all be going after. And I think the rest will automatically follow. That's my only input.
Jesus says, seek the kingdom of, seek the kingdom. Everything else will follow. Seek first the kingdom of God. Everything else will follow. That is what Jesus says, no? So, seeking, going after anything else, the word, you will not get word, you will not get God also. But going after God, you will get God, and God will give you the word also. So, only thing, our motivation should be correct. That, okay, I'm going after this, so I will get this. Then they were all mixed up.
Correct.
Where we go wrong.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And most important, sometimes we wonder why, how God will bless. So one key point in this is stewardship. How we are stewardship with what we get determines, that is my personal understanding. Our stewardship and what is, you know, being faithful in small things, is all this is all interconnected. That's why I said Bible is a complete and single truth. It's no compartmentalizing. So that means if we are, see, so, whatever we have got, we are not being very prudent in our handling our money. In terms of furthering the kingdom, even offering, so many things are there. That means that we are not being good steward of what is being entrusted to us. Then how do we expect God to be more generous to us when we are not properly stewarding what we have? That is also very, very important thing in my mind.
Agreed. I think you're 100% spot on. I mean, to quickly add a few instances from my life. I mean, I sort of literally turned towards God very, very late in my life. I would say I've actually lost a lot because it was only possibly in the year 2014, I really started making some changes in my life. And until then, yeah, you know, but my mind used to work like this. I used to tell myself, and I used to believe that I'm preaching to somebody when I tell them that, yeah, no, you have all the answers in the Bible. But did you know, I had never read the Bible at all until then. I was part of the youth when I was in church. I was, you know, I was a very active member. I used to do a lot of things, but I never read the Bible. That's the biggest blunder I did. And it was only the year 2014, I don't know, I had gone to Nigeria and, you know, I had joined a church where it was pretty different. And I started to learn and I got more involved, and that's when I realized. And over the years, I've sort of, you know, started to set for myself actually a goal. And what I did is I've just built myself something called the four pillars. This is what I call it for myself, for my own self, which is basically the four pillars in my mind are basically faith, trust, belief, and hope. And it's all in God. So that faith, trust, belief, and hope in God, I want to constantly strengthen. The only way I can strengthen it is by getting closer to God. The only way I can get closer to God is only through the Word, which is nothing but the Bible. So I'm only reading the Bible, trying to understand more of it, trying to learn more of it, trying to interpret it. And sometimes these kind of conversations, when I see, actually, they actually excite me a lot, because when I see so much of inputs and learnings that I get from all these discussions, I think are really excellent, and they help me strengthen these four pillars of mine, you know. So that's the kind of, I mean, that's where I am today. I still don't think I'm there yet, but I'm still battling within myself to still get closer to God and to get actually where I should be, but I'm still not there yet. That's what I can very confidently say, but I mean, I don't know, my faith, trust is all in him. I'm trying to put everything in him, but again, I'm human, right? So many times, my faith and trust, belief, it sort of drops for a moment. something I expect should happen, that expectation, it drops. And then I start to realize, I said, it's wrong. Let me not expect these things. Let me not wish for them. That's not what I should be wishing for, you know. So again, I correct myself, come back into line, read the Bible, you know, pray, try to get closer. So that's where I am as of today. But I think, yeah, I mean, it's an excellent session we've had today. I'm actually, I will definitely watch the recording as well. I think this will throw a lot of insights, give me a lot of insights as well. Thank you so much.
You said about the four pillars. No, that is important because otherwise, as the Americans, we are trying to pull ourselves with our boot, you know, bootstrings, they call, no? So trying to lift ourselves by using our bootstring is impossible. So that's what, that is similarly trying to be good in our, on our effort is useless. We thoughts help, it's impossible.
Right. In fact, my sister, she's actually in China. She's working in a school there as a teacher. Before she left for China, this was about 4 or 5 years ago, she was a person who would say that, no, God is not there. It doesn't exist. Jesus, he's all, only bad things have happened in my life. And that's how she used to be. But it took me a while to talk to her, coax her, cajole her. But today, I'm so happy to say that she is today a believer. Today, she will tell you and me that he is a living God. And, you know, it's really opened my eyes. And actually, I found her transform much faster than me. But I guess that's how God works, right? That's how God works.
Nothing is impossible with God.
Absolutely, absolutely. 200%.
Thank you, sir. I have to thank Kanagaraj, sir, for me to encourage me to do it. So it was a learning process for me also for one this week to learn some more.
So let me say a few words on that. First of all, thank you, Mr. Selvin, for this presentation. I'll just divide my opinion into three categories. One, the compilation of the presentation. Number two, the presentation. And number three, the contents. So as far as the compilation of presentation, it was excellent. And he has taken a lot of time on that and he has applied his mind. The thing is, most of the time when we make a presentation, we just copy a point from here and there and all that. It's an application of mind. But all these words, I can read that it has come from the heart of Selvin. Not that it is from his brain. It has come from the heart of Selvin. So that is an important aspect as far as this type of topic is concerned. It is not about what comes from the brain. It is about what comes from the heart. But I could see right through the presentation that it has come from the heart of Selvin, not from the brain of Selvin. That we should accept, and that we should try to emulate. That is one. So I congratulate him. I thank him for this excellent compilation of the presentation. Then coming to the presentation part, so I'll take some liberty with him because he is known to me for some time, and we have a common friend who is very close to us. So that way I take some liberty to give some advice. Brother Selvin, please be slow. As John said, so you have got a lot of things to tell us, but it will not be possible to tell within this 1.5 hours or 1 hour or whatever it is. So never bother about whether we are able to complete everything. The thing is whether we are just driving home the point which you are talking about. So a lot of information were there. Even in each slide, we want time to think about it, analyze it. So what I am thinking is whether you leave out some 10, 15 slides, it doesn't matter. Nobody knows how many slides you have prepared. So we are bothered about what is in that particular slide and we want to gain and digest it. So my request, or you can take it as an advice, fellow friend, I'm taking a liberty. I should not say that.
But I've taken the liberty. You can go slow and see that people are able to digest. That will be a better thing. And the last thing about the content, I'm not a fit person to comment on the content. So I don't give any comment on that particular thing. So overall, it is an excellent presentation. Thank you. Because I'm a very simple person. As far as between God and myself, I don't think I have analyzed these sort of things in my life. What Abraham Zacharias said and what John said or what Maxwell said, I've not realized those things. Right from childhood, I'm a Christian. I feel I'm always with God and I always feel God is with me. Whether I am with God or not, He is always with me. So that way He has blessed my life. So I'm not able to separate all these concepts. So I don't have any comments on the contents part. So overall, a big thank you for Selvin for accepting it. So thank you. Now, then Maxwell is not there. Maybe Brother John, you can say concluding prayer. And
I'll do that. Okay. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this evening time. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with your word, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the number of chartered accountants who can join. And thank you, Lord, for the number of CAs and friends who are going to listen to this talk by Brother Selvin. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us through your son, Selvin, Lord. Yes, Lord, when we trust you, when we obey your words, Lord, things will be good. It may not be like the way we expect, Lord, but you know what is good in our life, what is best for the society, and you will always be good. And you will do good things to us, Lord. Lord, we have learned so many things, Lord, today. Help us to practice that in our life, Lord. Help us to be better Christians. Help us to be reflecting you through the society, Lord, to the society, so that people will see us, and through us, they will see you and glorify you and your name, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Lord, especially for Brother Selvin and his family. Thank you, Lord, for his wife and the children and their families. We pray that you would bless them abundantly. Especially we pray for Brother Selvin. We pray that you would bless him abundantly and pray that you would use him more for your glory. Lord, you have given him the gift of sharing or teaching your word, Lord, if not preaching. He's so good in compiling. He's so good in presenting the truths, Lord. Lord, help him to develop it further and also use it for your glory. Let more and more people be blessed with the gift that you have given to him, Lord. Give him the opportunity to share your word in other places also, Lord. We thank you once again for every one of us who have come here, every one of us who joined and then who left in the middle. We pray that you would be with every one of us and bless us. We also commit our responsibilities, Lord. You know, the struggles that we are going through right now, the challenges that we're going through because of various problems that we face, Lord, COVID, the IT portal, the GST issues, FCRA issues, and so many, Lord. Lord, we pray that you would be with us and you help us, Lord. Lord, we are doing this as your children and we are serving your community. Let us not let down any of your children, any of your people, Lord. We pray that you would give us enough wisdom, strength, resources, and the health to complete the responsibility that are given to us. We also pray for the staff and the team that you have given to us. Lord, bless them all. Once again, we thank you. We praise you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, friends. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Nice.
Thank you, Aminsan. Thank you. Thank you, Christian, for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ibrahim.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to everyone. Sir. Bye.
Thank you all.
Yeah, this is Maxwell. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.